There we go. Looks like we're live now.
All right.
Awesome. Awesome. Perfect. Well, good morning, everyone. Don Cramer with Cramer Group Real Estate and the Cramer Group here with Joan Lindner. Welcome to the Thursday edition of Coffee with Cramer and Colleen.
Hey, Colleen, thanks for the invite.
No, absolutely. Thank you, Joe. Colleen is actually, we've got a listing going live today, so she sends her best, but I told her what we were going to be going over today, and she said, I wish I was there. So I said, well, let's just, you know, we're going to film this. We'll post it up online and chat about it afterwards. And also too, Joe, we're going to definitely have you back, but just to give everyone a little background, I've known Joe for quite a few years. He is he's the owner operator of Southern Nevada Computer Systems. We knew each other through a great organization called Biking Las Vegas. Special shout out to Lisa and Lynetta and all those that helped put that group together. So I was doing some road biking, met Joe through that. And boy, Joe was what we called one of the hammers. He was out there putting some speed and some distance in, and continues to do that today. But nowadays, Joe and I catch up quite a bit on a lot of business networking. But today we're really not here to talk about tech. We're talking about Joe's other company called Joe's Phenomenal. And I want to kind of get to know Joe a little bit more from that side, where he got into it, the passion, things of that nature. Because I know a lot of us with the stay-at-home orders, the fridge and the cookie jars are looking awfully entertaining right now. So, Joe, thanks for joining in today.
Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome.
And Joe, I know you've got it seems like not only just with starting Joe's Phenomenal, you have a distinct interest in food.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I've actually competed on MasterChef a few times too. Every time they have the tryouts anywhere close, San Diego, LA, sometimes they have them here.
Right.
I'll go ahead and I'll go try out, even though if I were to somehow make it onto the show, I wouldn't really be able to go on the show because I can't take 3 months off of work to do it. But I go because you get advice from professional chefs. They taste your food. They critique what you're doing. I mean, the information you get is invaluable. So, I mean, it's just one of the things you have to look at. Reality show tryouts or something like that. It's about what you can take away from it, not necessarily what they can give to you.
Well, that's awesome. That's awesome, Joe. So how'd the culinary food bug get into you?
Well, mostly it was, I've always liked to cook, which explains how I was, you know, back when I met you, I was about 80 pounds, 90 pounds heavier than I am now. And probably I'd already lost about 20 pounds at that point. But I've always kind of like to cook, and after I started dropping weight is when I really started paying more attention to it, because cooking at home, everything's just a lot more better. It's much, much better when you do it yourself than it is going out to eat, because you can control what's going into it. And at first it was more of a weight loss thing, and then it just became something where I was like, hey, this is pretty cool.
Awesome. So okay, so when I met you, I'm looking at you going, this is a guy who doesn't look out of shape. And you're telling me 80 pounds, because you're looking, okay, you know, tall, you're 6 foot?
6'1".
6'1". So, you know, you've got a body frame, you're biking, and it's not like you're riding, you know, with a gut or anything, but, you know, like you said, in your own right, you are 80 pounds.
Yeah, I had a gut back then, man. I was at, when I met you, I was probably right around 240.
Wow.
240 okay. pounds. I'm at 174 right now. And I'm actually about 3 pounds heavier than I should be really for racing.
Okay. But,
you know, all the races have been canceled, so it's not a big deal right now.
Yeah. And so let's talk a little bit about that. So again, through cycling, that you've kind of always worked on that endurance, you know, sort of hardcore endurance, 60 mile rides, you know, metric century rides, even some multi-day things, I believe.
Yeah. At first it was, you know, riding with this group that we used to ride with called Biking Las Vegas, which is how I met you.
Yep.
And that was pretty much, it was a whole lot of night rides. And, you know, we'd get 30, 40 miles in at a time. And then it became doing century rides. And then century rides weren't enough. So I started trying to race. And then I was terrible at that. So then I had to start working on getting faster. And part of that really was having to drop weight. I mean, it
Okay.
doesn't matter how strong you are. If you're heavy, you're fine on the flats. But as soon as you start going uphill, I don't care who you are. If you're overweight, eventually you're going to get popped.
Yeah,
That's just the way it goes.
exactly. And I've always, you know, I'm on the seafood diet. You know, I see food. I love it. And then biking, I remember doing that, and you're shedding the weight because you're needing to pick up speed. And I'll tell you what, going, just saying, you know what, I'm gonna go and buy some light parts for my bike or go to carbon fiber. No. Go drop 20. That's a good start.
Yeah, you know, it's, I always tell people, hey, you know what? You can go and you can get a $1,000, $1,500 bike that's pretty nice. And then you could drop a few pounds and save a little bit of money in the kitchen. Or you can go spend $10,000 on a bike and it's a pound less. Where it can cost you a lot less to lose that weight off of your body than it does
Absolutely.
to try to drop the weight off the bike.
So you're at a point where you're riding, but you're not, you're either through strength or speed, not getting quite what you want out of it. So is that sort of where Joe's Phenomenal began?
Well, Joe's Phenomenal began because you know, my cycling coach and mentor, Louis Emmelboro, he's actually kind of our local badass here in Las Vegas. It's kind of weird. He's got like all these World Tour pro guys call him,
Okay.
and
So world
like
class.
he'll, yeah, like I get to meet a lot of these people that I see on TV all the time, and when they come around town, they want to train with him. It just goes to show you what kind of skill level he's got. He's got just unbelievable amount of wins, stage wins, like overall wins, all kinds of stuff. And his team has always had this real knack for producing winners. So when I met him, I actually just really got lucky, and he kind of picked me up and started mentoring me. And you know, I've gotten a lot more success out of racing since then. But basically, what we were doing was we were eating at a restaurant, and we were just having these piles of salad, because you would, you know, you'd have a whole bunch of salad, and then you'd have your protein.
Right.
Well, we had this low calorie dressing, Italian dressing, that we were using on the salad. And then I was kind of thinking about it, because we went through like six bowls of salad with this low calorie dressing.
This is probably not the Olive Garden
Yeah,
unlimited
it's,
salad.
oh, it was the Olive Garden unlimited salad. You know, four of those big bowls,
One of those big
they
bowls.
enough to where they were visibly irritated that they were giving us more salad. But you know, after we left there, you know, I go, you know, Louis, I kind of calculated the salad dressing calorie content. I go, you know, we just had like 500 calories in dressing all by itself without any other food or anything.
Right.
And you know, and I already had a little bit of a cooking background. So I just started thinking, you know, I can cook. I do all this stuff. I come up with stuff in the kitchen. Why can't I come up with like a alternative for a salad dressing? So I just worked on it for about a month and just kind of came up with different stuff and tried to find ways to get the calorie count down without sacrificing the flavor,
Okay.
which a lot of times, if you buy diet dressing in the store, they're sacrificing. And it's the flavor they're sacrificing, because those things taste like, they're bad. They're
Oh,
terrible.
absolutely. No question. And it's always a struggle. And you know as well as I do. I mean, the common misconception is when they start doing these augmentations to dressings, things of that nature, it's they comp you know, there's a sugar compromise and in a lot of cases a sodium compromise, and then
Right.
whatever other 47 syllable word they put in.
Yeah, so I was looking at that and all the chemicals that are in there and everything else, and I thought, you know, there's got to be a way to do this that's not horrible, and that we don't have to put all this stuff in it.
Right.
So basically, I came up with my original dressing, which is the spicy lemon vinaigrette, which is really close to an Italian dressing. And I brought it over to Louis and had him try it out, and he couldn't get enough of it. And he was the one that told me you have to sell this.
Okay.
He goes, I've never had anything this good. You got to sell it. So that's kind of where Joe's Phenomenal started. He had the idea to get me going on the first dressing. Then I came up with it. And actually my fiance Bridget helped. The word phenomenal is one of her favorite words. She uses it all the time. Mm-hmm. So that's where the name Joe's Phenomenal came from. So you got her coming up with part of the name. Okay. And then Louis coming up with the idea to do it. And then, you know, my limited culinary skills coming up with, you know, putting the dressing together. So that's kind of where it all started. And it's been rolling ever since.
So this is, this kind of kicked off. What was the year when this sort of all kind of came together?
Well, last year was our first full year in business.
Okay.
And it's a little bit of a growth thing. You know, I've got the computer company I run. I've got this, I've got to race and train all the time too. Mm-hmm. So growth, it's just one of those things where I'm not worried too much about it just taking off into the stratosphere instantaneously, but we saw a lot of dressing. We're doing good. And it's always an upward motion. I mean, that's really all I'm looking at is just to keep that heading in the right direction. And then eventually we're going to be good. No problem.
So let's talk about the first dressing, the lemon vinaigrette. What drove you that direction?
Well, Italian dressing has always been my favorite dressing.
Okay.
And to me, of the ones that taste good, that are low calorie in the store, the only ones that I ever thought were pretty decent were the low calorie Italians.
Okay.
Because they sort of kind of taste like the real thing. So I just kind of started looking at ingredients and I'm like, okay, well, can we do it without the sugar? Well, I'll use either stevia or I'll use some monkfruit extract or something. And that worked. And then I thought, okay, do we really got to have the fat in there? Because I don't know. And I did it without a fat. No problem. They got all these chemicals in there to preserve it. Well, lemon juice, apple cider vinegar, those things are natural preservatives.
Right.
But, I mean, they're not going to preserve it the way a chemical does, but it's better than nothing. And those things worked out good. I don't add water into it. The mustard dressing has some water in there because that's kind of how you make mustard. But other than that, everything else, all the liquid in the dressing is either vinegar or lemon juice or something like that. It's not getting diluted at all, which is why there's so much flavor to it. And it's a bunch of Italian herbs and stuff like that. And you're talking 2 tablespoons, 5 calories.
Wow.
It's almost nothing.
So
and it tastes good. That's the main thing.
You're a person that, you know, there's some people that like light dressing or dressing on the side, but then there's some people that it's like, you know, dunked in.
Yeah, I like to, you know, you have like a little pool of dressing at the bottom of the plate when you get done. That's a good thing.
And you take the bread out. And
so the way I approached it was not so much let's make something low calorie. It was pretty much let me make something that tastes as good as I know how to make it taste. And then I'll worry about seeing what kind of calorie content it is. If I can just do something without putting a bunch of garbage in it. And it's always worked out. So I've never gone off saying, okay, you know what? This is a diet dressing, because to me, diet is a 4-letter word. It really is. Because a diet by definition has an end date. I'm going to diet. I'm going to lose 10 pounds. Well, you diet, you lose 10 pounds and you gain back 20.
Right.
Because it's really all about changing your life.
Yes.
And if you're going to do that, you better replace some stuff with some stuff that tastes better than the original stuff, because otherwise you're going to want to go back and get that other stuff again. It's just, it's the way it is.
So if you can,
I would do that too.
Better the old adage, a better mousetrap. And in this case, yes. a better salad dressing.
Yes, definitely.
So the lemon vinaigrette was the first one, and then sort of how the other flavors come about.
Okay, well, the original dressing is the spicy lemon vinaigrette, which actually I've got that sitting right here.
Nice.
There you go. Okay. It's kind of hard to see it with the glare there. I got 2 screens here, so it's, you know. Yep. Well, the spicy lemon vinaigrette was the first one, and you know, it's got a little bit of jalapeno and some other stuff in there. And then I figured I would make a regular lemon vinaigrette for people that can't really handle the spice, because there's quite a few people that, you know, especially older people, they can't handle as much spicy stuff.
Right.
So I did another version of it, which is the exact same dressing, but it doesn't have, there's no cayenne pepper in it. There's no jalapeno in there. And other than that, it's almost exactly the same. It's almost got the same flavor profile to it. So that's good.
Okay.
And then I expanded out and I decided to do something a little bit different. So I did a sun-dried tomato dressing.
All right.
So the sun-dried tomato dressing has got a teeny bit of sugar to it, obviously, because tomatoes are sugar. So, I mean, but it's
And
still.
is it the sugar from the tomatoes
Yes.
being cooked down in the sun, you know?
Yep. There's nothing you can do about that. And there's a tiny bit of fat to it because sun-dried tomatoes do have a little bit to it, but it's not much. You're talking 2 tablespoons, 2 or 3 grams of sugar, less than a gram of fat. So, I mean, it's tiny, minuscule amounts, especially if you're putting in a dressing. So the sun-dried tomato dressing is good. And that actually works really well as a marinade or a base for like a bolognese sauce or a stew or a chili. And there's a lot of stuff there. In fact, you know, I put recipes up on joesphenomenal.com, and when I
And
put
I'm
them
looking at
there,
it this week, exactly.
yeah, when I put them there, all the recipes there include the use of the dressings that we sell. And then if you go over to the Instagram page, that just has just whatever I feel like making. It's there regardless of whether it has anything to do with the dressing or not. And then my last dressing I've done is the maple monkfruit mustard dressing, which is my version of a honey mustard because I love
Oh,
honey
okay.
mustard. And honey mustard is basically just like sucking down fat because people don't realize honey mustard is sugar, mayonnaise, and a tiny bit of mustard to make it taste like not mayonnaise and sugar. And that's honey mustard. And I always, you know, and I used to eat a lot of honey mustard dressing.
Okay.
I thought I was doing good. I'm eating a salad. Hey,
All
lean
right.
salad. Here's a little bit of honey mustard on there, my nice 9 tablespoons worth. And then I just ate more than a Carl's Jr. superstar
Ooh.
just by doing that, because you're talking a lot of these salads you see at the in the restaurants now, so they have to show you calorie content. You're talking 1200, 1300, 1500 calories on a salad.
Yeah, absolutely. It's interesting nowadays, you know, because of those mandates for nutrition guidelines, and I know some people are against it, but I'm a big fan of it because you look at it and you go, "Oh my God, what was I eating?"
Yeah, people don't realize, you know, like a little bit of fried chicken in your salad is it's fried. I mean, it's gonna be there. And
Right.
sometimes those numbers seem so high that they can't possibly be right, but they're gonna put the lowest number they can on that page. So it
Exactly.
might even be a little higher than that. Who knows?
Maybe the steamed veggies aren't quite so bad. So we talked about, so we got the different dressings. So we get the but they're not just dress, they're not just for salad, like you said. You know, you've got some recipes here. You know, you're talking about using it as a base for a bolognese, things of that nature, chili. So give us a couple of ideas, because I think this is interesting for people to go, this is not just for shelving and when the salad comes out to use Joe's Phenomenal. This is where you can use Joe's Phenomenal in many as can. What are a couple of your favorites
Okay,
dishes?
well, we'll go right down on it. The lemon vinaigrette, excellent with salmon.
Okay.
If you want to marinate, in that case, if you're going to marinate a piece of fish, I would mix it with a little bit of olive oil because you want it to have a little bit of staying power there, get it a little
Okay.
bit thicker. Marinate some salmon fillets in that, then you got some pretty nice lemon salmon there. It's pretty awesome. The mustard goes amazing with shrimp. So if you do like a shrimp stir fry with that, then you get like this nice maple syrup flavor to the shrimp. It's pretty good. It's pretty
It's
awesome.
kind of that sweet and spicy.
Yes, exactly. Well, the spicy not so much, because if you cook mustard, it kills the heat.
Okay, kind
People don't realize that
of
usually.
melt
If
out.
you got mustard and it's a little bit too hot for you microwave it or you saute it a little bit, all the heat from the mustard seed will go away on that. The tomato dressing, like I said, that works really good. My favorite thing I've used that on is either a base for lasagna or in a chili. Because the chili, it's pretty much I just chop up some turkey breast. Actually, I use a little bit of ground turkey, throw that into a slow cooker, put a bunch of that that tomato in there, then you got some vegetables and some beans and stuff, and then you leave and come back 4 hours later and you got some pretty nice chili there.
That's
real
awesome.
Easy. Yeah.
Yeah. And so you're not just solving one problem with some dressings. You've got a couple solutions where, you know, one pot meal, complementing meals, things of that nature coming together out of one bottle.
Oh yeah. And you could have a serving of chili that ends up being like 250 calories that you would swear is just like something you got out of that you just made yourself. That chili typically has a lot of calories to it.
Right.
But you know, it's actually a lot lower. So I mean, there's ways to do it. You don't have to sacrifice the flavor. In most cases, it actually tastes better and it's good for you. So, I mean, you know, what more could you really want on something like that?
Yeah, no, absolutely. Absolutely. So Joe, we've talked about, are there one thing I like to do is marinade things. Let's say you talked about like the shrimp or the salmon. So it's like, I like to take a lot of times chicken breasts or quarters, marinade, Ziploc. Mm-hmm. Is there any one of these that you would recommend?
You can use any of them for marinades.
Okay.
The tomato stuff, that's better probably for a soup base. The lemon cuts into the, you know, it, that'll really soak into the chicken or whatever you're...
Because the acids and the...
Yeah, yeah. You want a little bit more acidity there for something like that.
Okay.
The mustard and the lemon vinaigrette work extremely well for that kind of thing. The tomato, it's better just as a salad dressing or as a base for a sauce, which is good too, because I mean a lot of people like to use tomato based sauces, and it's not quite as acidic as a tomato sauce per se, a regular tomato sauce. So you don't get that kind of that feeling like later on that you know what I mean. You feel like you had something that was too rich.
Too acidic in your system.
Yeah, and it just kind of bugs you. It kind of bugs your stomach a little bit. You don't really have that problem too much with this, so that's nice.
Well, actually, that brings up another good point. So because you're riding and with some of these things, for people that are in sports, you know, whether it's cycling, let's say tennis or things that they're exuding calories or energy over a couple of hours, how does your, you know, your system play in with part of their diet, either before, during, or after?
Okay. Well, definitely not during. if you're expending calories, you probably are taking in calories. It's not a good idea to skimp too much on that.
Right.
But as far as the prep goes, if you're in a sport that weight matters, anything where you're dealing with your power to weight ratio, which is especially, it's probably cycling is the number one sport in the world for power to weight.
Yep.
Rock climbers deal with that a lot too, because you need the most muscle possible with the least amount of fat on you as well, because it just takes a lot of power to go uphill, and the leaner you are, the better you are, mm-hmm. period. And really that's just a matter of over time, you know, making sure that you're as lean as you can be. You know what I mean? Because you're going to be doing extra work for every pound. I think on a bike, for every pound that you weigh, it's equal to about 3 watts.
Okay.
So, I mean, if you weigh 10 pounds heavy, if you're 10 pounds heavier than me and we're trying to go up a hill together, you're going to expel over 30 watts more than me sustained for the entire course of that hill just to hang on.
So for me, I'm kind of like, I need to bring my own nuclear power plant.
Oh no, yeah, you're pretty strong, man. I remember riding with you. You do all right.
Not too bad.
But the thing is, the less you weigh, the better off you're going to be, especially in that. Even runners, because you fit, and that's going to be a lot easier on your knees. That's one thing I found, even though I'm not much of a runner.
Yep.
Man, if you're out there trying to jog on a treadmill or run around the block or something, or even run on the beach or in the grass, the amount of pressure that's not in your joints when you're trying to run just from a few pounds of weight loss, it's amazing. Because you feel like you're going to break your kneecaps off if you're 30, 40 pounds overweight trying to do that. And there's nothing more demoralizing than being in severe pain after you try to exercise. That makes people stop. They just quit.
Oh, absolutely. And I've heard stories about people that are overweight, and then they start running or things. Next thing you know, you've got stress fractures. And so,
yeah. Now, Bridget, my fiance, has got some problems with her femur, and that's just from, she's competes on horseback. She used to be a runner, and she ended up with a couple of like hairline fractures in her femur. And it's just one of those things where she just can't run anymore because it's too hard on her body.
The damage.
And that's somebody who is an athlete.
Right.
Who is a trained athlete, who is in excellent shape. So, I mean, that just goes to show you what a lifetime of running can do to you, because it's so hard on your body.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So, Joe, we talk about, one of the little side titles of, or subtitles of Joe's Phenomenal is salad dressings and more. Is outside of the, we've got dressings, we've got marinades, we've got sort of bases out of there. Anything else?
We're working on merch, a little bit of merch coming. I got these shirts, had these shirts done up. We're working on a couple of designs that we'll sell those. We got hats on the way. There might be, I'm kind of figuring on maybe getting into some sort of like an herb blend or something like that to go in. Everything would basically be centered around healthy alternatives and stuff. And so I'm still kind of playing around with what else we can put up there. It's just one of those things where, it's slow growth. Just like, I don't think I will add another flavor to the dressings probably for quite a while, because we want to, keep it small and good. And, we don't want to grow too quickly either, because that could lead to problems as well.
Right. No, absolutely. So here's, I guess, a challenge, or have you thought about this challenge? I believe me, I love mayonnaise. I mean, there are people that admit to it, and then there's people that lie about not loving mayonnaise.
It's pure, it's joy.
It's egg and oil. It's good. So, when you have those sort of mayonnaise-y or creamy based, what would be a good transition off of that?
Non-fat Greek yogurt instead of the mayonnaise.
Okay.
Non-fat yogurt, regular yogurt isn't quite as healthy as Greek yogurt. Yep. But you got to do a little bit more to get the Greek flavor out of the yogurt, because that's going to affect the dressing flavor. But okay. I could do a Greek yogurt based Caesar dressing, and it comes out nice.
Okay.
Comes out with the anchovy paste in it and everything. But that's one that I haven't been able to do, because I can't bottle it as Joe's Phenomenal, because I can't do it without a preservative. And I won't. And that's just one of those lines I won't cross. And it's caused some issues with groceries a little bit, because it's not going to sit on the shelf unrefrigerated. Basically, you buy some of this dressing, it goes in the fridge whether the bottle is open or not, because it's not going to live indefinitely on a shelf, because it needs the refrigeration.
Exactly. So this is a good point. So because there's no preservatives in your dressings. Number one, people can go online to joesphenomenal.com to place an order. So the order comes in. How long are we looking? How much should they order? Or,
well, you could. It just depends on how much dressing you use. I go through half a bottle a day. Okay. But I use it for a lot of stuff too, though, and we eat a lot of salad around here. But as far as shelf life goes, they'll live in the fridge for quite a while. You're fine for a couple of months, easy. Okay. And I've made them so, the natural preservatives that are in there, like the lemon juice and the apple cider vinegar, that'll preserve it enough to ship it. So okay. I figure I don't have any problems if somebody lives 4 or 5 days away. I could ship to them. I'm not going to worry about it going bad during shipping or anything like that. So that's good. It's just whenever they get it, they need to go ahead and refrigerate it. They don't want to just stick it in their pantry or anything. Other than that, they're probably pretty good. I've tested some of this stuff for a couple of months, and it's not, I haven't really had any problems with any kind of bacteria or anything in them. And the mustard is pretty much bomb proof, because that's all mustards are. Yeah, mustard seed kills bacteria all by itself. So I mean, if you're a bacteria and you can survive in mustard, then more power to you, I guess.
We may have to test the mustard on some coronavirus there, then.
Yeah. Yeah, could be.
There you go. Well, Joe, anything else you wanted to kind of mention or talk about?
We could just get into the diet aspect, which actually, because it's kind of a passion of mine. Dieting isn't really part of the dressing, even though the dressing is very low calorie and it's good to use in a diet. But that's not really the point of dieting because, me and Bridget we're always working out, and I train, a couple hours a day in the gym, plus 15, 16 hours a week on the bike, plus running two businesses. So it's busy. But people get the wrong idea about, how to go about things. Number one, the word diet is a four-letter word. It's a diet. A diet means I'm going to do something for a certain amount of time to reach a goal, and then I'm going to stop, which is why all diets, I don't care what it is, Atkins, being keto, if you're just on it for a diet or whatever.
Oh, and I heard this
When,
30-day thing, fat,
yeah. Yeah,
there's
when the end date comes, you gain your weight back because people think they've completed their goal. Changing your weight is not a diet. It's a life change, which is why I was so passionate about getting the dressings to taste really good, because you want them to replace something permanently. You don't want to go back to doing something else. I can't tell you how many times you go to the gym and 95% of the people you see there, they're there because they're overweight. A lot of people, I mean, there's a few people in there that are really fit that are in there and they're working out for competition or whatever. But the vast majority of people go to the gym to lose weight, and that's not what you're supposed to do. The gym is for fitness. It's for increasing your fitness. It is not for dropping weight. Dropping weight's in the kitchen, and that's a big problem for people. They'll get on the treadmill, and then the treadmill tells them, "Oh yeah, you burned 1,000 calories." But I guarantee you, there's no calorie counter that's accurate. You need to take the number that your calorie counting says you're burning, and you need to take that and cut it in half, at least, depending on your level of exertion. If you're running for an hour if you're jogging on a treadmill for an hour, you're probably burning 400, 450 calories maximum. And that's if you're going pretty good. And it
Is there
also,
sort of like a maximum output, if somebody was full tilt for an hour, what they could spend? And that's sort of kind of a stable number, isn't it?
Well, it depends on the person. It depends on your physiology. It depends on your level of fitness. It depends on your muscle mass. It depends on your age, your sex. There's a lot of stuff that goes in it. And it's, about, what zone your heart rate's in and a whole bunch of other stuff. I mean, I've tracked everything I put in my body for several years now. Every morsel of food, every bit of exercise. And when I go and do a hard, like 65-mile simulated race on the weekend, where you're just killing yourself for the entire time, I'm logging that as about a 2,000 calorie burn, and my bike computer is telling me like 4,500, 5,000. But and a lot of people believe those numbers. But then you look at it from a different standpoint, and you say, does that mean I can go and eat a large pizza? Because that's about what a large pizza is, about 5,000 calories. So I should be able to ride every day
And eat a
like
pizza.
that and eat a pizza every day and not gain any weight. But it doesn't work that way, does it?
No.
And it's tough. It's really hard to get people past that. So, it's pretty cut and dry though. It is calories in and calories out if you're trying to drop some weight. But the calorie burn has to be correct, because you can control what you're putting in your body, and you can kind of measure that out and see what you're putting in. But what's going out is a much harder number to calculate, and it's better to know that you need to assume that you're burning less than you think, and assume that you're eating a little bit more than you think too, because if you're not writing it down, you're probably getting some snacks and stuff, and I'll go and I'll grab a piece of cheese or something, and from time to time, you're watching a movie and then you went four times to the fridge. It's
Well, and
especially now.
that's an important thing going on right now. I mean, you know, we see a lot of posts or comments about, you know, rating, you know, rating the pantry, rating the refrigerator time and time again, with that people really weren't doing. I mean, back, you know, they'd have maybe their breakfast or a cup of coffee and then lunch at the office or whatnot until they got home. Now home, you know, 10 feet away is the entire food supply.
Yes. Yeah, that's rough. That's
So,
really rough.
Joe, too, about this, you talked about diet, and I liked your comment about the kitchen is where you control the calories. Now, what about what I you're not just training, you're very fit. You work, you like you said, you're putting a lot of cycling in. Have you done anything different with your practice and your lifestyle with the at home, or is that because of your business and setup? It really hasn't changed a lot.
My difference since the quarantine started is instead of riding with my team on the weekend, I have to ride by myself. That's the only difference. I'm eating exactly the same because that's the way we eat. So I always eat in that same way, and I've always trained the same amount, and most of my training has always been indoor. So as far as the training goes, no different. The gym obviously isn't open, so you got to do some weight training at home. So that probably isn't, I'm not getting as much as I used to on that. But again, the weight training is for fitness. It's not for losing weight. And probably with the sport that I'm in, I don't want to really be bulking up a whole lot anyway, because muscle mass is still weight. So it's tough.
Yeah, you don't quite see Chris Froome out there, you know.
Now he's tiny. He's a lot smaller on television. You know, they say that the camera adds 10 pounds. Well, it adds a lot of pounds for those guys, because they are skeletons with larger legs. That's basically that's pro cyclist right there.
They have kind of a top level cyclist kind of has a slightly deformed look. You're like, okay, that doesn't look right.
Yeah, like a 12-year-old boy on your upper body, and then your lower body, you got some nice quads on you.
You look like a Olympic leg presser.
Exactly.
Joe, one of the things too, I mean, with, you know, in my line of work, I mean, I work from home, I office from home, but also too, I don't ride. I'm not out there on the bike like I was, but I am on a indoor bike, a spin bike, and I know that it has helped me build energy, get the heart rate up to get through the day. Because there was a little transition period where there was I you know it was you know you're kind of a slug. I mean, I could tell that, okay, energy levels weren't up. And so it's not, like you said, it's not just about diet and exercise, it's about kind of building your body up for peak performance, whether it's at work or at play.
And that's actually an excellent point, because if you've noticed, since the coronavirus epidemic came about and everybody got quarantined, you see an awful lot of people walking around, walking their dogs, playing with their kids, going for a run, riding their bike, jogging. You see people doing a lot of that stuff. And I think a lot of it is boredom. And a lot of it is people are scared and they feel like they need to take care of their body. Because if there's anything I do know is that if you're looking at it from a pandemic point of view, if you're taking care of your body, you're a heck of a lot lower risk to something like this. Your cardiovascular system's in better shape,
So absolutely right.
you're at a better weight, you're not on meds, you have higher energy levels, you have a stronger immune system. Like I don't really worry. I don't go and visit my mom right now because my mom is, almost 80 years old. And it's just, I figured, I better leave her alone, and I'll bring her some groceries if she needs something or something like that. But I don't want to be around her too much because, what if I'm carrying a bug or something like that and she gets sick? I don't want to risk that. But as far as safety for myself, I'm not concerned about me getting sick at all, at all. No more than getting a flu or anything like that. Not saying that it's not not a terrible disease to get and it's not dangerous, but I just don't feel scared for myself as much as I would for other people, just because I've done all the work and made sure I've taken care of myself and got myself into the best shape I can be.
Yep. So
it goes a long way. I mean, it's a big stress reliever to not have to worry as much about something like that, you know, as other people might.
No, exactly. I mean, just the side benefit for me, you know, I am carrying weight. So doing spin, or if I was getting out on the road bike, you know, one, there is sort of, okay, I'm exerting some calories. I'm doing more than just being a sedentary human being. Mm-hmm. I'm getting my heart rate up, but two, very much so when I kind of looked at this originally, I said, okay, you're asthmatic. You're overweight. You're going, okay, if I catch this bug, and I've caught flus or colds before, and some of them have been more debilitating than others. And this one's pretty bad. I mean, I don't know, you know, it's pretty gnarly, even though some people say they're asymptomatic. But if you're in sort of some of these risk classes, like I am, getting on the bike or getting out walking, building that immunity system up, getting your heart moving, getting your lung capacity up, but also too with you and Joe's phenomenal, you're also putting stuff into your body that your body isn't going, what do you want me to break down here?
Right. Actually, Dr. Fauci, actually during one of the press conferences, actually mentioned that the best thing you can do for your body is what you're putting in it.
Yeah.
It's your nutrition that's going to help you the most out of everything, because that's really, I mean, you build a lot of foods that increase your, you know, you eat foods that help increase your immune system.
Yep.
That fight off disease and everything. I mean, there's a lot to be said about having a healthy diet with fruits and vegetables and lean proteins and stuff like that. It's just good for your body.
Absolutely. So Joe, I know we're this has been an awesome conversation. Let me ask you one last question. Do you have a guilty food pleasure?
Yeah. And if you go on my Instagram page, you see I'm a dessert guy.
Okay.
I am a dessert guy. I just did a, it's just funny because I just posted a sour apple cherry pie. Ooh. That I just did. It's all from scratch. So it's got, you know, like lime zest in it and honey crisp apples and fresh cherries. And it's just tons of sugar and just delicious cherries and whatever, you know, nice buttery crust. And basically I did it because for a friend of ours, I love cherry pie. I have to, it's hard for me to pass the Edelman's cherry pies at the grocery store that are 50 cents a piece. But I can't have them. But it's an excuse for me to get to make stuff like that. We got friends that we're making them for, so I'll make a couple of pies and then I'll give one to them and then I'll cut the other one to a bunch of pieces and I'll have like a little piece of it and then give some of it away to clients or something and then I'm done with it.
So is, I get to have that recipe up there on the Instagram?
Yeah, it's on the Instagram. It doesn't have the measurements of everything in it, but
okay.
If anybody ever wanted that information, I could kind of tell them exactly.
Okay. Awesome.
Stuff on Joe's Phenomenal has all the actual measurements on it though.
Fantastic. Well, Joe, this has been awesome. I've enjoyed talking to you about this and kind of catching up, you know, kind of about, you know, your journey from cycling several years ago to now and how that became Joe's Phenomenal. You know, and ladies and gentlemen too, we're also going to have Joe back as well, because Joe is Mr. Tech. So, you know, I'm sure, you know, too, we're going to be asking some questions about a lot of changes during and post Corona as mm-hmm. to how to set up your business office, because I think that's going to be a long staple going forward. But if anyone wants to reach out, we're going to put Joe's links in the comment section below. But if you have any comments for Joe, definitely put them in the comments, hit the like button and such. But go check out joesphenomenal.com, also his Instagram page and such, to see some of the great things he's doing. So Joe, thanks for tuning in.
Oh, thank you so much.
This is awesome. So again, ladies and gentlemen, Colleen, you're going to see the taped version yourself, but you'll meet Joe on a future episode, I'm sure. But on behalf of Colleen Schaefer, I'm Don Cramer with the Cramer Group at Urban Nest Realty. For more now than ever, your real estate experience matters. So give us a call. And we appreciate Joe being on Coffee with Cramer and Colleen, where we not just talk about real estate, but we also talk about lifestyle and community. So again, please reach out to Joe, and Joe's phenomenal. Because right now I think, you know, having the right diet and a good exercise plan will get us all through what's going on right now.
All right. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Joe.